I was more AG than I knew I was, if you know what I mean. Like, growing up, I did everything that you can imagine. I did Bible quiz. I went to kids camp. That was the highlight of my summer. I remember begging my parents to let me go to kids camp, and they would always say, it's so much money, and it's only 1 week. But I begged, like, on my knees. I said, I will pay my way to go to kids camp just to make it. Because you have to understand, at Pendel, we have the best kids camp. We meet at the Bongiorno Conference Center, and there's so many things to do. We have services each week. There's actually opportunity to go rafting down a river, which I thought was pretty cool. I enjoyed it. But the real reason that I went, and I don't think I was able to admit this to myself until maybe many years later. If you know anything about Bongiorno Conference Center and what it's like, actually, I have not been there recently, so I don't know if this is still the case. On the playground, are there still tetherball poles lined up? There are? Okay. Now I have to go back and make a trip. So I think the real reason I went to camp at Bongiorno Conference Center was for the tetherball. If you know me, I'm a little competitive, just a little. I like to win, like, a lot. So the tetherball for me was not just about having fun with my friends. Tetherball was about crushing my opponents and everyone in my way. Just to give you an idea of, like, when I say I was competitive, my parents bought me a tetherball pole for my backyard because of this. Okay, and you're like, whoa, that's extreme. Yes. Every single summer, from the time I was in middle school to high school, my hand was swollen twice its normal size. Like, I am not kidding when I say, like, you think, oh, that's funny. My camp counselor called my parents because they thought my hand was broken because it was purple and swollen to twice its normal size. I would, if you know about tetherball, there's a rope, and I would get it caught on my wrist. And you guys know, like, rope burn, but, like, repeated rope burn, it doesn't heal very well. I would have year-round tetherball scars on my hand. I loved tetherball. So I was a little bit proud of the fact that I was good at tetherball. And when I went to kids camp, I had an arch nemesis. Well, I don't know if they would consider themselves to be my arch nemesis, but they were my opponent. I won tetherball. I was undefeated. You have to understand, like, undefeated, until Dalton stepped onto the court. It's okay. I've let it go since then. And I've chosen to forgive, but I'm always up for a rematch. I think the most, like, I didn't realize how much it affected me until my parents, when I came home from camp, asked me how camp was. And the only thing that I would say to them was, I was undefeated until Dalton. And I will never forget, and I will never forgive that person for beating me at tetherball. Like, I was beating camp counselors until this person. You understand? Like, okay, I was just a little competitive, and it's still, clearly, I'm not healed all the way from it. And I think, as I'm reflecting, okay, Sophie, you need to mature and move past this. But I thought it was kind of funny how, at a place where I actually remember, I received baptism in the Holy Spirit at camp. I remember talking to my friends and having deep conversations about Jesus at camp. But if you asked me what I remember from camp, all I could say to you was, I lost a game of tetherball. Isn't it funny how sometimes in our minds, the things that we fail at become so significant to us? How sometimes our failures, or the things we regret, or the things we wish we would have done, overarch and overwhelm our perspective of our lives. I wonder today if there are some of you here that if I asked you, how's your semester going? The only thing that would come to your mind are the failures and regrets that you have. I know it's been a long semester, and I know the Lord has done amazing things on this campus. I know that He's moving in your lives. I've seen it firsthand. But I also know that with those things come regret and failure, things that we think back on and we wish we would have done better. Maybe it's relational failure. You think of friendships, relationships that you failed. Maybe it's academic. Maybe it's athletic. Things you know you could have done better or that you made the wrong choice on. I want us to ask ourselves the question today, as followers of Jesus, what do we do with our failure? But more importantly, I think it's important to know what Jesus does with our failure. Amen? If you're following Jesus, which is more important, what you think of your failure or what Jesus thinks of your failure? So let's go to the Word of God. We're going to be in the book of John, chapter 18, if you want to get a head start. You can turn there. We're going to look at the life of Peter. I love Peter. I'm sure many of us are familiar with Peter's life and his many failures. But we're going to look at one of them that I think is more magnificent than all of the others. More incredible that he would fail in such a magnificent way. So if you're in the book of John, chapter 18, by the way, the context of this is when Jesus has just been arrested. Okay, so he's just had the Last Supper with his disciples. They've all sat around the table. He washed their feet. You guys remember what Peter said when Jesus was washing his feet? Lord, you should not wash my feet. Jesus said, if you don't let me wash your feet, you have no part in me. And so Peter, he always goes from one extreme to the other. He's like, then wash every part of me, right? This is the Last Supper. Then they go to the Garden of Gethsemane. And Jesus takes the three disciples who are normally with him off to the side, and they all pray, and Peter is there in their midst. And you think, you get this picture, he sees Jesus and the agony in the Garden of Gethsemane that he's going through. He's witnessing it. And then Jesus is arrested and betrayed by one of his closest disciples. And then this happens. So John chapter 18, verse 15 says this. Simon Peter and another disciple were following Jesus. Because his disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard, but Peter had to wait outside at the door. The other disciple, who was known to the high priest, came back, spoke to the servant girl on duty there, and brought Peter in. The servant girl said, "You aren't one of this man's disciples too, are you?" she asked Peter. He replied, "I am not." It was cold, and the servants and the officials stood around a fire they had made to keep warm. Peter was also standing with them, warming himself. Read on in verse 25. It says, meanwhile, Simon Peter was still standing there. Meanwhile, this is while Jesus is being on trial and interrogated for his crimes, right? And it says, meanwhile, Simon Peter was still standing there, warming himself. So they asked him, "You aren't one of his disciples too, are you?" He denied it, saying, "I am not." One of the high priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, interesting note that they had that, challenged him, "Didn't I see you with him in the garden?" Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, a rooster began to crow. Let's pray. Jesus, you know our failures. You know the moments that we come short. And you know our regrets, Lord. I just pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord, would you come? Would you minister to us today, Lord? Would you speak to us what you want us to hear? Would you give us hope for our future in you, Jesus? We need you, Lord. We need you. In your name we pray. Amen. I don't know about you, but sometimes I wish that I had the opportunity to talk to Jesus face to face when he was walking on the earth. Do you ever think, like, when problems come up in your life, sometimes, this might sound bad, like, abiding just isn't really enough? Okay, I can say that because I've done it and I've been in low moments and you're like, I just wish I'd had Jesus that I could bring in the room, sit down, and ask him the answer to my questions. You know what I'm talking about? Like, wouldn't that be so nice if we didn't have to, like, pray and seek for answers in scripture, and just, Jesus could just tell me, right? He could just tell me what my issues were. I think sometimes we forget, Peter actually had that. Okay, let me put some context for you. You guys are here at UVF for maybe 4 years, right? Maybe. Most of you probably 2 or 3, because you transfer in or you're really smart, you take classes before you get here. So some of you are going to be here for 3 years. And having talked to those of you who are freshmen and you've already been here, you're like, I feel so different from when I first arrived. You guys know what I mean? Like, so much has changed about my life, about the way I think about the world, about my friendships, the people that I choose to hang out with. So much is different about me. And some of you who are seniors, you're looking back and you're like, I can't believe it's only been 4 years or it's only been 3 years. Everything about my life is different. Everything about my life has changed. Okay, you are spending 3 or 4 years in spirit-filled loving community, right? People who love you, but you're not spending 3 or 4 years with Jesus in person, right? Okay, imagine if UVF was not like if Jesus was here. Do you think you would be different at the end of that time? Like if he's in person here, you're able to talk to him? Okay, now think you're not just around Jesus, like able to like hear him speak to you in chapel, but you have the ability to go and stop by Jesus's office and talk to him. That would be nice. I kind of wish I had the opportunity to do that. Okay, now you're not just able to go and stop by and talk to Jesus. You're in his closest circle of friends, the 2 or 3 people that he spends the most time with. Do you think you would be changed? Okay, this is Peter's life experience. Peter spent 3 years with Jesus. 3 years watching Jesus respond to things. 3 years watching Jesus love people. 3 years watching Jesus perform miracles. Peter walked on water. Okay. If you walked on water, like, what? For me, I get excited when it's like, I feel the Holy Spirit telling me to encourage someone in something, and I do it, and they're like, how did you know? And I'm like, oh my gosh, Jesus, use me. Peter, he walked on water. He drove out demons. He healed people. Like, is that not amazing to you? Think if you're in Peter's shoes, you're walking with Jesus, you're experiencing and seeing all of these things. And we know that Peter's not perfect. Okay, he walked on water, yes, but he also fell in. Okay, yes, we probably would do the same thing, right? If we were being honest with ourselves, Jesus said to him, you have little faith, why did you doubt? Ouch, Jesus, that hurt a little bit. But do you realize that Peter had interaction with Jesus, like confronting him and holding him accountable? Like, okay, you think of discipleship and how we hold each other accountable in discipleship. The perfect discipler was Peter's discipler, right? So even if the person who's discipling you, right, they hold you accountable, but sometimes they're flawed too. They're learning to follow Jesus too. Peter's discipler was Jesus. Okay, that's a little bit of pressure. Peter, get behind me, Satan. Do you think Peter is learning in his failures? I took piano lessons a lot growing up. My mom made me. And I don't understand because she didn't make my other siblings. I think my life was unfair. They took piano lessons for a year and said, Mom, I don't like this. And she said, okay, you can be done. I took piano lessons for 10 years. Do you think I enjoyed that? 10 years of my life I spent practicing piano. The worst but also most helpful feeling was when you're really stuck learning a piece of music. Like, you are working at it, you're spending hours on it a week, above and beyond the practice, and you're still not able to get it right. And you go in to your music teacher, and they put the sheet music before you, and they play it perfectly. It's like, what are you doing? And they're like, oh, let me show you where you got it wrong. And then they mark off for you all of the places, right, that you were making the mistakes, and you're like, ah, this makes sense why it didn't sound good. It's kind of the same thing as like what happens when you're in school and you're trying to learn math and your teacher is showing you all the places that what's helpful when a teacher comes alongside you and shows you the right way to do things, you grow and you learn, right? I'm saying this, like Peter had live feedback from Jesus about his life. He had live feedback. So not only did Peter walk with Jesus for 3 years, not only did Peter experience miracles and see them happen and perform them through Jesus's power, but he was actually held accountable and discipled by Jesus himself. Isn't that amazing? Sometimes when I mess up and I make mistakes, these thoughts go through my head like, man, if I just spent a little more time with Jesus this morning, maybe I wouldn't have made this mistake. Like, when I'm in a grumpy mood, and I'm not a morning person, okay? So I go into work in the mornings, and people try to talk to me, and I'm like, don't talk to me. Please don't talk to me. I avoid them. I run away. Reverend Gail, Jesus, they will tell you. I keep my office door closed in the morning. When I wake up and spend time with Jesus, right? Sometimes I'm in those grumpy moods and I'm like, I just did not abide enough this morning. If I was spending more time meditating on the word of God, then I wouldn't have this problem. If I was just closer to Jesus, then maybe I wouldn't have done this. Let me ask you, who of us could be closer to Jesus than Peter? Think about what I just said, like what his experience was. If there was any person on earth out of the 12 disciples who knew Jesus, it would have been Peter, right? And yet, the servant girl brought Peter in and asked him, "You aren't one of this man's disciples too, are you?" He replied, "I am not." They didn't bring Peter in and put him on trial and say, "Deny Jesus or we will take your life." Right? He wasn't like put on the hot seat and everything that he loved was going to be ripped away from him. It was just a little girl. And she asks, you were with him. And he says, "No, I was not." I'm like, Peter, if any of us would have answered that correctly, it should be you. And yet, he doesn't get it. I don't know if you can relate to that feeling of, I thought I would have gotten this down by now. Like, I really thought after all of this time and all of the investment that's been put into me that I would have known better than to make this mistake. And it's not even like, it's not even that hard to not make it. So why am I stuck here? For me, an example of this is this semester, all my small group facilitators know this. Every single week, we send out small group prompts. On Friday? Question mark. You guys are supposed to get them on Fridays. Most of the week, you get them like Tuesday morning. And this has been something that like took me a while to figure out why I was like frustrated with myself. And I was like, oh my gosh, it's because I'm behind on this every single week. How many, like, Even our little failures impact how we see ourselves and how we think other people see us and how we think Jesus sees us. Think about how Peter must have been feeling. I think in all of those other times when Peter is walking with Jesus and he fails, there had to have been something in the back of his mind that is like, I'll get it next time. Like, it's okay. I fell into the lake, but I will get out. I'll dry myself off. And Jesus is still here with me. I'll get it next time. In this moment, I think it hits Peter, like all of those other things, he's been able to say, at least I'll get it next time. And this time he's like, will there be a next time? How many, like, you mess up so much, time and time again, in your mind, you've given up on yourself. You feel like there's not gonna be another chance for me. You think, if I've failed so many times, how will I ever get this right? I want you to imagine Peter at the foot of the cross, knowing the last thing he said about Jesus, and looking up at Jesus, suffering and dying, and in his mind, replaying the failure of the few nights before. Do you think sometimes we replay in our minds the mistakes that we've made? I can imagine Peter feeling like, is Jesus done with me? Now, out of all of the Gospels, John is the only one who records the next part of this story, the last part, which we're going to go ahead and read. And it's the most important part. This is how does Jesus respond to Peter? If you turn to John chapter 21, Jesus has already appeared to his disciples two times after being raised from the dead, before this happens, okay? So if you're talking elephant in the room for Peter, he's like waiting for the moment when Jesus is going to address this with him. You know what I mean? Like, he's waiting for it. He's watching. The disciples, just before this, they're out on a boat. They're fishing. And Jesus is on the shore. What's Jesus doing? He's cooking breakfast, which I love because I love breakfast. And he knows that they need a meal. And he gives them some instructions on fishing, how to catch more fish, which is common. And then they catch the fish. He brings them. Jesus cooks them fish over an open fire. And they eat together. So they're sitting around. This is the setting. The disciples are sitting around this fire, eating a meal with Jesus. And then it says this, John 21, verse 15. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hand and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. I think Peter, in his mind, is taken back to the night when, over a fire, warming himself while waiting for the results of Jesus' trial, He looked at a small slave girl who said, "Do you know this man?" And he said, "I do not." And here Jesus is sitting around an open fire with his disciples, and he turns to Peter and he looks him in the eye. And Peter, aware and conscious of his deepest failure, Jesus says, "Do you love me?" What's happening here? Jesus is not just forgiving Peter. That's part of it, right? He's forgiving Peter for what happens. And the three times that Peter denied, right? Why does Jesus ask him? I think Peter knows. He knows what he did. But notice three times Jesus follows up and says, "Feed my lambs, take care of my sheep, feed my sheep." What is Jesus doing? If I'm Peter, the question on my mind is, Jesus done with me? Have I gone too far? Is this where he's going to tell me off and say, "You've messed up enough, you can't be one of mine"? And instead, Jesus says, "I have a calling for you. I have a purpose for your life. You will be shepherding my people." Our greatest failures in the eyes of Jesus do not keep us from his call on our life. When Jesus says at the very end, "Follow me," you get a flashback to when Peter, meeting Jesus for the very first time, Jesus says, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." If there's anything Jesus could have said to give a clean slate, it was this. "Remember when I first called you? My plans for you, my purpose for you, my love for you is the same. Just come and follow me." Jesus doesn't belabor what happened. He doesn't make Peter grovel. He says, "Come, follow me." How amazing is this scripture? Do you see what Jesus is doing? He's not just forgiving Peter, he's giving Peter purpose in his life. He's giving him a call on his life in the midst of the failure. Do you wonder if sometimes we make our failures in following Jesus about ourselves? "I've messed up too much this time. Surely I couldn't be useful to the Lord now. I've failed him again. Surely I have done the last straw." When Jesus is saying, "Your calling to me was never about you and your worthiness, but always about me. Come, follow me." As the worship team is going to come, I'd like us to respond to this invitation of Jesus. What are regrets that you're carrying this semester? What failures are in the back of your mind when I ask you, "How's your semester been?" Are there things that you think, "I've messed up and I've gone too far. What is Jesus going to do with me?" I think Jesus calls us to himself and says, "I have a purpose for you. Your calling is not about you. It never was. It's not about your righteousness. Don't be silly. I have finished it. It is done. Come, follow me." That's the call of Jesus, to pick up our cross daily and follow him. Even in the midst of our mistakes and our failures, followers of Jesus are people who realize it's always about the righteousness of Jesus and never our own ability to fulfill the law. but only about Jesus and his work, what he's done. If you would stand with me, I'm going to ask you just to close your eyes and reflect. What failures are you holding on to? What things do you keep replaying in your mind? What regrets do you have that you need to lay at the feet of Jesus? You need to see Jesus look in your eyes and say, "Follow me once again." I'm always comforted in my mistakes and failures, because if Peter walked with Jesus for 3 years and got to talk to him, and yet Peter can be restored, how much hope there is for you and I. How much hope there is for you and I. If even Peter, who walked on water, held the Messiah in his arms, can be restored, how much more you and I. We're going to sing this song. If you want to come and lay your failures at the feet of Jesus, he's calling. He's calling. Let's sing together.
Come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh. I heard it broken within, overwhelmed by the weight. Jesus is calling. And have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Whoa. You won't come to the altar, the Father. His arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought. Blood of Jesus Christ.
Peter in that moment across the fire from Jesus, and I hear Jesus' words to me, follow me, releasing the burden of my guilt. Oh, I just want to hug Jesus. You know, do you feel the same? When Jesus lifts the weight of guilt from you, there is no other response than just adore Jesus. Just hold him tight. Just stay close to Jesus. There is joy in come follow me. Forget your past and leave it behind. Today, if you're wearing the weight of your guilt or your failure, leave it at the feet of Jesus. And just hold tight to Jesus. Hold tight to Jesus in worship. In worship. Can we sing, Oh, What a Savior, one more time? And then we'll close in prayer together. face. Oh, how good you are. Oh, how merciful you are. How kind. How kind you are to say, follow me. Forget what is behind. Lord, would you help us hold tight to you, Jesus? May we always hold tight to your work finished. Leave our failures behind, oh Lord. We need you, Jesus. I pray for power to leave our failures behind us today. Holy Spirit, would you help us? Lord, we love you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for freeing us, Jesus. We love you. I pray that you would go with us. Be with us, Lord. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Amen. You can continue praying and seeking the Lord. If you have to leave, do so quietly.